Good morning and welcome to the 18th meeting of the committee in 2015. If you wish to use tablet devices or mobile phones during the course of the meeting, please switch them to flight mode as they may otherwise affect the broadcasting system. Some committee members may refer to tablets during the course of the meeting. That's because we provide papers in digital format. Agenda item one today is to decide whether to take agenda item three on consideration of the oral evidence we have received today in private. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. Agenda item two is our main item of business today, which is an oral evidence session on the complaints process for joint health and social care services. This is the latest in a series of sessions we have undertaken over the last 4 years to establish how effectively public authorities are responding to the public sector reform agenda. Members will recall that concern over the complaints process for joint health and social care were brought to our attention by the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, Jim Martin, back in January of this year. The aim of this evidence session today is to ascertain what progress, if any, is being made in relation to the establishment of an effective single public complaint handling process following the integration of health and social care services. We are also seeking clarification on the role of the SPSO in handling subsequent complaints made to him which arise from the integration of health and social care. We have one panel of witnesses this morning, so I'd like to welcome Paul McFadden, the Head of Complaint Standards at the Office of the Scottish Public Services Ombudsman, Iona Colvin, Chief Officer for Health and Social Care Partnership in North Ayrshire, Alison Taylor, Head of Integration Implementation at the Directorate for Health and Social Care Integration of the Scottish Government, and Rami Okasha, Acting Director of Strategic Development at the Care Inspectorate. Before we move on to questions, would any of you like to make an opening statement? Mr. McFadden, would you like to go first?
Yeah, I'm happy to kind of open with, given that we had raised these issues to the committee in January. As we said to the committee at that point in January, and as we have said over a number of years through various forums and consultations, some of the concern around this area dates back to the Sinclair report, which was published in 2008. And the Sinclair looked at complaints system across Scottish public services as a whole, and as the committee knows, made a number of recommendations about trying to simplify and make those systems less complex. There was a particular focus in that report around the area of social care complaints, and within that social work complaints, a recognition that this was a particularly complex and confusing area for vulnerable users. And particularly in relation to social work, a recognition that that system was outdated and not particularly effective. A number of recommendations, including one which would simplify the social work complaints system and give the complaints review committee that currently sits within local authorities to the Ombudsman's office, and a number of other recommendations and observations around wider care complaints. At the heart of the issue, I think, here is the fact that there are separate legislative processes for the various different areas around social care, and also separate standards within each of those separate processes. So for social work, you have the statute of social work complaints process with very kind of clear and specific timescales and stages and standards throughout that process internally. Signposted into a complaints review committee before you can come to the Ombudsman, and our remit in relation to social work, because of the complaints review committee's role around professional judgment, is quite limited. Secondly, you have the health arrangements under the Patients' Rights Scotland Act, which is a streamlined process, but it's slightly out of step at the moment with the kind of wider complaints processes that we've put in place, and of course social work. And then, of course, you have the care complaints, which are made directly to the Care Inspectorate. Our view, shared by a number of others, which we referred to in our briefing to the committee, is that there is a risk, a particular risk to vulnerable users in this overlap and confusion. This is something which is raised with us by local authorities and our health boards involved in the complaints arrangements, and it's something that we see coming through in terms of cases to our office. Integration has come along since that process, and we have been very supportive of the integration agenda, which we think will be positive for users. But we have raised concerns that it's possibly a missed opportunity, at least, and could possibly even increase the confusion around complaints here, unless there is quite specific guidance and detail around the arrangements that the integrated areas should be putting in place in terms of complaints. We're seeing, you know, bits and pieces of progress, and we've always had constructive discussions with all the various branches of government on this. I think social work, we know that we are moving towards it, but I think we do need some kind of firm timescales on when the changes to social work are going to come in place, both to ourselves and to local authorities. Constructive discussions around health. I think there is something around integration and providing a bit more clear guidance to ensure that the arrangements that are currently being developed is consistent. All of these areas are currently developing processes in isolation, and I think, as the committee knows, we've worked very hard over the last few years to standardise and bring a clarity and consistency to complaints handling across the rest of the public sector. And I think there is an opportunity to work with the government to publish something which helps us develop that level of consistency in relation to this area too.
Thank you. Ms Colvin, please.
I just welcome the fact that you're looking at this and that we need to move forward in terms of simplification of the process and I think coordination in terms of the different bodies involved. So we'd completely agree with everything that Paul has said there and just look forward to the discussion. I think from the point of view of a chief officer, sure, members are aware, but the three Ayrshire partnerships have been established now as integration joint boards were established on the 2nd of April. And at the moment, I think we're the only ones that are established so far. From our point of view, what we're trying to do at the moment is simplify the process from the point of view of the people who use the services. And also, we will simplify the process at the end of that so that there is important performance information going before the IGIB as well as to the NHS and the councils in order that they can see very clearly about both the level of complaints about services and the outcome of complaints about services. So for me, those are the important points at the moment. We navigate the rest of the complex process, and I'm sure that's probably what you want to look at today.
Thank you. Mr Okasha, please.
Thanks very much. It might be helpful if I just say a little bit about what the Care Inspectorate does and our role in relation to complaints. Convener, we regulate 14,000 care services in Scotland in both children's services and services for adults and older people. And we do that in order to support improvement where that's required, where services aren't operating at a sufficient quality level. And some of those services will come under the purview of the integrated joint boards and do the integrated arrangements, but other services that we regulate might not, for example, childminders or school care accommodation and so on. So we will work across a number of different landscapes in that sense. We investigate complaints about the quality of care in those care services. And last year we received 4,400 complaints, which it was a significant increase from that from 2 years ago. What we try to do with our complaints process is not simply resolve problems for individuals who are currently experiencing them or dissatisfied with what they have experienced, but try to use the information and intelligence we obtain from complaints when planning our inspections and our scrutiny to make sure that what we're doing is in the different parts of Scotland is justified by the evidence we see. At the same time, leaving aside what we do within individual care services, we provide scrutiny of social work services in Scotland, currently undertaken through a joint arrangement with Healthcare Improvement Scotland and with other regulators as well, where we have joint inspections of the Community Planning Partnership, where we look at how well services are working together, both for children and for adults in those areas. And with integration coming on stream, we'll undertake additional responsibilities around strategic commissioning and looking at the impact of new arrangements on the outcomes for people who are living in the areas. So we have a particular interest in making sure and would expect that chief officers in each of those integration boards have a robust system in place for dealing with complaints at the lowest possible level where they can be solved.
Thank you. Ms Taylor, please.
Thank you, convener, and thank you from myself as well for this opportunity to talk to the committee about complaints. My job has been to lead the policy and the legislative work around integration for the last few years and now to oversee aspects of its implementation. And I think as a starting statement for this, what I would particularly want to reflect on is that right at the heart of integration, the only reason for doing it is to improve the user's experience of health and care, and to improve people's families' and carers' experience of health and care as well. So this is very much a person-centred approach, and that must also obviously apply in the territory of complaints, and I think more broadly than that, also in the territory of listening to people generally, in involving people and communities in the integrated strategic planning of services, so that people's voices are built in from the start of planning, if you like, and also, of course, that the experience of complaining is smooth and integrated, does not present in itself further hurdles, and is clearly understood. I think we've done some very useful work in recent time with colleagues both in the SBSO and the Care Inspectorate, and more broadly in the inspection agencies and elsewhere. Three things in particular came to my attention from the papers for this session. Reflection, naturally, on progression for the NHS complaint system to the SPSO model process, which government has committed to seeing in place in the next 12 to 18 months, which I think will help to provide some consistency with other aspects of public sector complaint processes. As you'll know, the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport convened a short life working group on social work complaints recently. The recommendation of which was to remove the complaints review committee stage of that process, and likewise to move the social work complaints process to the SPSO model process. I think that's also good news. It again confers some consistency in terms of the application of process. We have more work to do with colleagues regarding the timescale for that. The third aspect of this, clearly from our point of view, is how these new bodies, these integration joint boards that the legislation has created, feed into complaints processes. And clearly I can answer more questions on this as members would find useful. There are two particular aspects to it that we have dealt with from the start. The joint boards are colloquially referred to as partnerships. Each partnership has a scheme of establishment, and that scheme of establishment must explain how complaints processes will be integrated from the perspective of people living in the area. That's one safeguard we've put in place. We will also move each of these joint boards, also known as partnerships, to the jurisdiction of the SPSO in the coming months, but we can't do that until they're each established, because they must each be consulted on being added to the SPSO's jurisdiction. And finally, guidance. Yes, indeed, over the next year or so, there will be some requirement on us, I think, with our colleagues, to develop appropriate guidance to ensure the processes are clear to people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. At our stage one look at the Public Bodies Bill, a submission from Carers Scotland was quite typical, and they said, "We believe that one complaint procedure should be introduced for integrated partnerships to avoid confusion for people who use services and carers." Now, what we're describing here today is somewhat confusing, even to us around the table. So God only knows what that's like to folks out there. And even as it stands at the moment, sometimes I have to think before I give folks advice about where they need to go to follow up their complaint. Now, Mr. McFadden said at the outset there that bits and pieces of progress have been made. Well, quite frankly, we don't want to see bits and pieces of progress. We want to see a system that is robust from the outset, which people can have faith in. And, you know, you said, Ms. Taylor, that all of this will come under the SPSO jurisdiction soon after the boards have been consulted, and then there will be the issue of guidance after that. Have we really put the cart before the horse here? Because I would have expected for all of this to be dealt with before the introduction of this kind of service delivery. I'll let you go first, Ms. Taylor.
Thank you. I think we've ensured the horse is in front of the cart in part through the provisions we've made about what must be in each partnership scheme of establishment. So The local experience of complaining and ensuring that that is a satisfactory and integrated experience for the person making the complaint is a responsibility that sits with the partnership, which is why we've said that in order for the Cabinet Secretary for Health, Wellbeing and Sport to sign off each of these schemes, there must first be a sufficient statement indicating that making a complaint locally will be a simple and straightforward process for the person making the complaint. I think the system processes that go around that, particularly in terms of moving the IJBs, the partnerships, to the jurisdiction of the SBSO, are driven by the legislative requirements of how they can be added to the jurisdiction, if you like. But the first and most important step, I think, is that local bottom-up step about how the partnerships will deal with complaints as they arise. And the chief officers, obviously, will have a very important role to play in that.
Ms. Colvin, what do the chief officers think of all of this?
I think I welcome some of the changes that are being proposed, particularly around the Social Work Complaints Review Committee and moving the NHS system under the SPSO as well, because that will make life easier. What we're working on just now is a front end to the complaint system, so that it doesn't matter where you are in the partnership services, be the NHS or council, there's one direct route in to make a complaint. And thereafter, we will navigate the processes that require to be navigated either through the NHS process or through the council process. Sometimes, often, because people don't live in the wee boxes we put them in, it involves complaints about both services. So we've just recently, I am obviously responsible for the operational side of all of health and social care within North Ayrshire, including mental health services for the whole of Ayrshire and Arran. I've just appointed a joint management team, so they are all jointly responsible. So everybody in my management team is responsible for social work and health services. So my head of community care, for example, is responsible for NHS continuing care beds and for the care homes, for example. And we've just now appointed managers underneath them, all of whom will have a joint responsibility. So we're taking it seriously in terms of that joint ownership and joint responsibility. So when members of the public complain, we need to deal with their complaint, and we need to sort it out behind the scenes and give them back one response, regardless of whether it contains an element around NHS and council. The complications obviously come quite often, particularly I think some of the most complicated complaints we get relate to child protection, and in Ayrshire and Arran, childcare services are part of our partnership. And that can involve a number of agencies. Quite often people will go to SPSO, who will then refer them back because they haven't been through the Complaints Review Committee process. They will also contact SSSC, who have not been mentioned so far, but who also have a responsibility in regulating practice of the practitioners involved here. And quite often they all write to every MP, MSP and councillor. So it does become quite complicated often in terms of dealing with it, but our basic aim is to make sure that we simplify that from the point of view of the person who uses the service.
Simplification would be good, because what this committee has found on numerous occasions when we're dealing with complaints is that people feel that there is a lack of communication. They're not signposted where they need to go to. And we are well aware of situations which have reached stages which they never should have if the communication had been right at the very beginning. And I think one of the things for individuals is that if they are very clear from the outset about how their complaint is going to be handled and all of the stages that they can go through, there tends to be a level of satisfaction compared to those folks who are not signposted, who are not communicated well to, who at the end of the day may reach the level of the SPSO or the care inspector or whoever it may be. All level of reasonableness has gone by that point, and no matter what you guys say, they're still going to be absolutely dissatisfied. So I think the key thing for us here is to ensure that signposting, that communication takes place instead of this pillar to post. Because quite frankly, folks shouldn't have to go to their MSP, their MP or their councillor to deal with this. Claire, I think you wanted to come in on that point.
Yeah, it was just a supplementary on that discussion. You mentioned that the Cabinet Secretary has to sign off on every joint board's procedures in terms of the initial one. But I'd just like to get a feeling of how variable those procedures may be. And could we be in a situation where one local authority, one joint partnership is working significantly different from another one, and how the Ombudsman would actually view that situation in terms of monitoring performances across Scotland?
We'll take Ms Taylor first and then Ms Colvin.
The requirement for these schemes that the Cabinet Secretary signs off is that they must describe how the experience of complaining will be streamlined and integrated from the perspective of the person making the complaint or their family. Which is, I think, actually quite a narrow requirement. In the schemes themselves, the description tends to be fairly consistent, because what it describes is the kind of arrangement that Iona has referred to, that teams will work together from an integrated perspective, and in particular, there will be no question of someone making a complaint being told to go and give it to somebody else. I think that's fundamentally one of the most important things, that there is a single point of entry, and that any mechanism for working out what needs to be done with the complaint is a process shouldered by the organisation, by the partnership, not by the service user or their family member or whomever.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely the case. I mean, in Ayrshire, we've worked as three. There are three local authorities, as you probably know, and one health board, and we've worked as three to achieve consistency. And in this, we will work as three as well. And obviously, that's a requirement from the health board. You can't have a health board with different arrangements. And to be honest, some of it is, to me, it's common sense. It's something, I was previously a CCP director in Glasgow City, and it's something we did in Glasgow City in terms of joining up the front end and joining up the back end as well, so that we make sure that we've got clear performance reports that indicate what people are complaining about and the outcomes of those complaints. So I think it's relatively straightforward in terms of the front part and the back part. It's the bit in the middle at the moment where we have to navigate the different parts of the process. And to come back to your point here, at the moment that is quite complex, but I think it's incumbent on us to be able to guide people through that and be clear with people what that process is and how we will deal with them. We are aiming to deal with people, most people, at the lowest level possible, so that we can resolve their issues and not have complaints that end up in front of SP. So that is absolutely our aim. And for the vast majority of people, we do manage that. There are some complaints that are very complex, and there are some people, very few people, we're always going to use every mechanism to complain. And sometimes they're very complex issues, and they have to do with deprivation of liberty, of removing people's children from their care. They have to do with very serious issues, which have very serious implications. But I think as we move forward and try and join up the system, I think particularly, I mean, for me, the people who get passed from pillar to post most are the elderly and people and carers of elderly, as they've tried to negotiate our systems. And the whole point of care, integration of health and social care, is to join that system up as well. And that's what we're currently doing, is we're in the process of joining the system up. And therefore, we need to join up the system whereby people can complain, so they can make one complaint and we can deal with it. And that's what we're endeavouring to do. And our aim is to have that front end and the back end of it in place by April next year. In the meantime, we will endeavour to deal with everybody's complaints as we can. We're also actively involved in...
Because you're talking about the front end and the back end.
Yep.
Right. And you hope to, you endeavour to have all of this in place by April next year.
Yeah.
And you said, and I'm paraphrasing here, the confusion is in the middle.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you know, hearing that doesn't give me much hope in terms of what's going on here and how you're going to be able to do this properly. This scenario of confusion about the middle,
yep.
you're painting a picture whereby you hope to have everything dealt with at the very beginning of the complaints process.
Yes.
That's what we would all like to see.
Mm-hmm.
But we live in a world where that doesn't happen all of the time.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if there is confusion in the middle, then that is going to lead to a huge amount of consternation amongst those folks who feel that their complaint is not being dealt with properly. Am I right?
Yes, but I think that colleagues have explained the steps that they're putting in place to deal with the confusion in the middle. I mean, part of it is about the role of the Complaints Review Committee for Social Work Complaints, the role of the Care Inspectorate and how the role of the Care Inspectorate relates then across. And sometimes, so in actual fact, you can end up with a number of agencies involved in looking at complaints. But I suppose what I'm saying is we now have joint managers and their job is to make sure that we deal with that on behalf of people so that we explain how complaints will be dealt with. And as we navigate through the systems, I think colleagues are saying the proposal is to change the systems in the middle.
I am a punter, right? I have a complaint, right? I feel that my complaint has not been addressed at the very beginning. That then is escalated and you bring in the manager. But I, as a punter, have lost faith at that point, right? I have got no idea what the set procedure about where my complaint is going to go. Am I not going to think that this is just an attempt to cover up and not deal with my complaint? If I do not know the processes, if that is not laid out properly?
No, we will lay out the process and we will lay out the entry point. So basically what we're saying is we'll have one point of entry for complaints and then it will go into the NHS process and then and into the council process. Basically. And that's how we'll have to manage it in the meantime until such time as it's joined up. And that's what we need to do, but we will make it clear to patients, service users, clients, whatever people want to be called, that that's how we will deal with the process, and we will take the responsibility of making sure that that is explained to people. So if the complaint is not dealt with by the front line, it will be dealt with by the senior manager who has responsibility for the NHS and the council services within their remit.
Mr. Okasha, you've been dying to get in.
It was really just in response to the point that Ms. Adamson made about the information about different things that are happening in different parts of the country, and it was to offer the committee some information about how we intend to work with other partners to provide some baseline information about what is going to be happening in different parts of the country. We're very cognizant that integration is something that is happening rather than has happened, and that in that sense, what we think is that a strong evidence base about what is actually happening and the experiences and processes around the country is important. So we will be working with Healthcare Improvement Scotland and Audit Scotland to monitor and review the implementation of the integrated arrangements over the coming years, not just in respect of complaints, but right across the piece around integration. So in year one this year, we'll be providing some baseline information on the basis of, or setting out what we know is happening around the country and how integration is beginning to work. And in later years, what we'll start to do is apply some evaluative judgments about how well that's beginning to work, and then move on to say, and what impact is that having for people who are actually living in each of the areas? So I think some of the questions you answered about, well, what is happening in different parts of the country will be provided by an evidence base from ourselves, from Audit Scotland and from Healthcare Improvement Scotland over the coming years.
Mr. McFadden.
I think, just to kind of pick up on a lot of what Iona and Alison were saying, I think there's a lot of positives in there in terms of commitments to things like a single point of contact, a single point of entry, a single coordinated response irrespective of where the responsibility lies at the back end. And that is positive. I think our experience of looking at the integration schemes, however, is that they are very general in relation to complaints, and they make kind of commitments, and I think there's very little in the detail of how that is actually going to happen. I think there's a reason for that, and I think the reason for that is that the legislation and the legislative basis for these are conflicting, and this is not just a confusion for the citizen, it is a confusion for staff and managers that we speak to, because I think you're trying to bring together and create these single point of entries and this clarity when you have a very complex system in the background, and they're struggling to kind of do that. So I think, you know, I think we do need to focus on the fact that the first step to this is legislative change to bring these together, and I think, you know, we've commitments to move towards that. The unfortunate thing is that that's not going to happen until probably until the end of next calendar year. So we're, after the point of integration, we're going to have the ability to have this very clear legislative framework to create that very clear complaints process. But I do think that is the priority, to get a clear timetable for that and communicate that to those that are developing these processes. I think in the interim, I think we can provide something which does the best job, if you like, of trying to bring these together and make it clear to both staff, managers and the citizen about how all these complaints should come through and where they should be routed to the Complaints Review Committee or the Health Service or the Care Inspectorate. It wouldn't be ideal, but I think it's something that, that would help in the interim until we get the legislative background fixed. Now, at the moment, I think what we are seeing and what we're being told from people in the system is that all of the integrated areas are doing this in isolation, so they're developing their own little solution to this very complex problem. And I think what we've been seeing is, you know, in other parts of the public sector, we have developed a very detailed and standard template for how this should be operating, our complaint system should be operating. Developing something similar would be of great benefit, I think, to the integrated joint boards. And I think it would ultimately be provide something which is as clear as it possibly can be in April for the citizen. And thereafter, we have to deal with the kind of bringing together the social work, health and other legislative aspects.
Thank you, Convener. The integration schemes, there are 31 of them in the public domain at the moment. There are 31 partnerships. But they haven't all been signed off yet. So the Ayrshire 3 have been signed off, and those three partnerships are fully functioning, which is why it's very helpful that Iona can speak with us today. And a further 14 have been signed off by the Cabinet Secretary, but the remainder have not yet been signed off. And it's as we go through this sign-off process that we ensure that everything is in order and that this particular commitment about ensuring an integrated experience of complaining is in there. I've had a few questions from a whole range of sources asking why such and such a scheme has got away with X, and the answer is, well, it hasn't, because it hasn't been signed off yet. It's in the public domain in draft form. So as we go through that sign-off process, we will be making sure that these matters are in order, although, as you quite rightly say, Paul, the scheme is not the place for a huge amount of detail on any one particular aspect of local integration. We have it in mind to issue guidance to IJBs, the partnerships, by the end of this summer. And I think it would be particularly helpful if we were to work closely with our colleagues and other agencies, particularly the SPSO. Yes?
Yeah, because you're talking about guidance, but Mr. McFadden is talking about legislative change.
Yes.
Is the guidance enough to deal with this? Or are we going to have to go back and come up with primary legislation to make sure that this all works?
No, we have to make a change to secondary legislation once each partnership is established to put them within the jurisdiction of the SPSO. But recognising that that will take us to the end of the calendar year, as Mr. McFadden said, we realise we can't leave a hiatus. So what we're going to do is issue some guidance in the meantime to make transparent that that's our intention, also to cover the Cabinet Secretary's intention to move social work complaints to the model three-stage SPSO process, as NHS complaints are now, and to set out expectations in guidance for the kind of template that Mr. McFadden refers to, how complaints about integrated services ought to be managed. And that's what we intend to do in the summer.
John Molson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just to follow on from the Convener's earlier point, one of the things I think this committee is attempting to do is to try and make it not only clearer for ourselves to understand the complaints procedure, but in particular the public, because what I've heard seems to be a very cluttered landscape in terms of anybody at the present moment trying to make a complaint. Ms. Taylor, you made reference to the 31 partnerships that are being currently worked on. Could you give me an example of what you mean by a partnership?
Yes, absolutely. I'm pleased to do that. A partnership is a health board and a local authority who together are required under the Public Bodies Joint Working Act to create a what's described in the legislation as an integration authority. Each health board and the local authority with which it is operating, they're in the same geographical area obviously, is required to create this partnership to which they delegate some of their functions and some of their money. And that's what brings health and social care together in that area. So for example, NHS Lothian, here where we are is in partnership with the City of Edinburgh Council. So that's one partnership, the Edinburgh Partnership. But it's also in partnership with East Lothian Council, and that's another partnership. Is that a reasonable explanation?
There's an explanation, but and you said the geographical boundaries. Yeah. I'll give you an example, mm-hmm. a recent example that I picked up, where a patient was taken into a neighbouring hospital, neighbouring to that boundary, not within that partnership area, was released from that hospital with a catheter, was released without any care support because they went back into the local authority they live in. In those circumstances, my understanding is there wouldn't have been a partnership between the local authority and the neighbouring health board. What happens in those circumstances when the patient wants to make a complaint? Because who do they complain to? Do they complain to the NHS board that they were in hospital with, or do they complain to the partnership in the area that they live in?
Invite Iona to describe.
They can complain to their own local partnership, because if it's an agreement with a neighbouring health board, then their partnership will be part of the service level agreement with that health board. So, for example, in North Ayrshire, many patients from the north coast of North Ayrshire go to Inverclyde Royal Hospital. And so I liaise with Inverclyde Royal Hospital, and in fact we have been having some ongoing discussion about complaints that arose, not so much from patients but from GPs about the functioning of Inverclyde Royal Hospital. So it became my responsibility to then liaise with the board, the health board people who hold the service level agreement, and to intervene in that discussion. So where it's so that's quite clear. Although they were being treated by Greater Glasgow and Clyde, they were patients from North Ayrshire, and therefore we had a responsibility to sort that out.
How do we get that message over to the general public? Because, as I said, the confusion that arose was who do they make the complaint to, who do they deal with? But at the present moment, would that still apply, given that, you know, in Ayrshire we have got the partnership agreements in place, but as I understand it from what Ms Taylor said, there's still a number of partnerships to be signed off by the Cabinet Secretary. What would happen at the present time for a patient that found themselves in that situation where there was that conflict between the health board that they were treated in and the integrated partnership that they actually resided in? But there's no partnership agreement in place, as I understand it.
Ms Colvin.
Well, I mean, imagine that technically it would be the health board from which they come from that would have the responsibility, because that health board holds the service level agreement. So, I mean, we are working towards a position, and it's disappointing to hear of your constituents' experience, but we're working towards a position where people should not be discharged from hospital without a plan. And that care plan, so my social workers and care at home workers go to Inverclyde Royal Hospital and assess people in Inverclyde and organise discharge plans. Occasionally, people are discharged without the discharge plan in place. That shouldn't happen, but I know that it does, and clearly it does, because your constituent has had that experience. But that is the position we're working towards and where we would hope to be, so that at any point when somebody is being discharged from hospital, it's clear who is responsible for their care within the community. And clearly that's a major issue for us. As we take on more complex procedures within community, and our nursing staff have to take those on, and GPs take responsibility as well, then it's absolutely critical that people are clear who is responsible for their care, and that their care transfers back to the community. So a lot of the work we're doing just now is really focused on how do we join up the community in hospital, because that's as much of a problem as has been the divide between health and social care at points, is between hospital care and community care, and that's part of what we will be measured against in terms of the national outcomes in relation to the partnerships, and that ideally is what should happen. But my gut instinct is that the NHS, Ayrshire and Arran in our case, hold the service level agreement with Greater Glasgow and Clyde, and therefore have a responsibility to intervene on behalf of their patients.
Mr McFadden.
Yes, I think discharge is actually a good example of where this most commonly crosses over, and complaints that we see under the present system do cross over these different areas. And I think just to highlight the complexity for the person who's wanting to complain, the elements that would relate to the health board would have to go through that health complaints process and then come to SPSO, where we have a rollover clinical judgment, we have a remit over clinical judgment. The elements which are actually very interrelated and joint, but are about the social work assessment or related to the local authority, they have to go through the statutory local authority complaints process and then come to SPSO. We'd have actually quite a limited role to look at it. We get complaints, we have, and we do get complaints, would these come to us, and we're looking at the person being taken through these separate routes, and they come to us, and we're having to unpick and cross-refer with different powers and different complaints. Now, that's because of statutory complaints process, and I think that's the issue that is going to remain until these statutes are aligned and removed. So it is going to be a challenge for them to get the board to do this. But I think the kind of example you're talking about, I think the kind of things that have to be put in place are very detailed and clear arrangements that you're talking about of what happens in this circumstance so that a staff member knows.
We're there because we're talking about detailed arrangements and all of the rest of it again. And we know that these detailed arrangements are missing something in the middle. But you guys just now have kind of skirted round the issue that Mr. Wilson was getting at. Who do they complain to initially in that case? And you know this?
Well,
you've not been able to give an answer. You really have not been able to give an answer. And the very least I would have thought is that you would have said that you would be able to signpost that individual to who that initial complaint should be made to. But even at this moment in time, there seems to be a lack of understanding about where someone initially goes. And that, I have to say, really, really perturbs me. Ms. Taylor.
I think it's clear that initial complaints are directed to the partnerships, because that's why we've brought health and social care functions, budgets, planning and delivery together. And each partnership has a chief officer. Now, I'm not about to suggest that every complaint should be directed individually and personally to the chief officer, but it's incumbent on the partnership and the chief officer to ensure that there are integrated arrangements in place, as articulated at a high level in the scheme, to ensure that that process is straightforward. I think in terms of the very concerning problems with discharge that we've discussed very briefly, I think what this helps to illustrate is a point that comes up quite often with integration, which is that such problems have existed for quite some time and are in fact, in a sense, what integration is designed to address. What we need to do, I think, is ensure that we work together to ensure that there is clarity of understanding about this route in for complaints and for other ways of engaging with integrated partnerships.
Mr. Okasha.
I think what's important to convener, and I think in one sense you put your finger on it, which is about saying that there needs to be a joined up front of house approach. So if somebody approaches somebody, be it in the care sector or the health sector, and says, well, I'm unhappy, I want to make a complaint, that they're not told, well, I'm sorry, I'm the wrong person to complain to, that actually yes, they're supported exactly. And assisted. And that is the expectation that we would have of partnerships as they're developing. And I think it's where our expectation is the chief officers will be able to put in place the appropriate systems to make that happen. And what we can offer in future years is some evidence to justify, to verify the extent to which that has happened and identify improvement support to be put in place if that isn't happening.
Thank you, Mr. Okasha. Some common sense comes into play.
No further questions.
Okay. Willie Coffey, please.
You stole my question that I was intending to ask there, the good questions. I was keen to find out just what a person's experience is tomorrow if they make a complaint about any aspect of the service, whether it's the local authority, social work, care inspectorate, even or NHS. Just what happens? Who do they go to? And what's their experience? Even tomorrow or next April, if there's a single point of contact and a single complaints experience, what does it look like? Is it a complicated but single form? What do they do? What do you envisage will be the experience of a person raising a complaint either tomorrow morning or next April when these processes are fully integrated? What will it look like? Can you tell us?
Who's going to go first? Ms. Taylor.
Well, I think Mr. Cash has put it beautifully. It will look like making a complaint to someone in the partnership, an appropriate person. There will be different circumstances, I imagine. Some of these, as Iona said, some of the circumstances surrounding the provision of care under integrated arrangements are really, really complex. Often to do with people in really vulnerable moments of their lives, towards the end of their lives quite often, there will be different circumstances in which the need to complain arises. And the key for me is that in making a complaint, the person doing so isn't pushed about or told to go away and go to someone else, that the complaint is accepted by whomever it is made to, and then the system carries the burden of, working out what should happen and who needs to be involved.
But you said the person will complain to somebody in the partnership. I mean, how do you make that initial leap? A person who's coming out of hospital or whatever circumstances they find themselves in, wanting to complain, how do they go about finding somebody in a partnership?
Okay.
You know, what do they do?
Basically, I suppose if they're receiving services from the partnership, then they'll have a frontline worker who's working with them. And we also will give information to everybody about how to make the complaint. So that's partly what we're working on. I'm trying to think. If it's somebody in hospital, for example, who's coming out and there's a problem with their care package, then they can complain via their social worker or via their district nurse, probably whoever's in there delivering the service. And that person will take the complaint, regardless of whether it's about the social work component or the health component of the service, and will deal with that complaint. And that's where, what we're trying to do at the moment, and we're training our staff in relation to that. So we're trying to move away from our siloed systems, and it's a bit difficult because we're kind of in transition. So in some places we still have the siloed systems where the social workers come in and the nurses come in and perhaps the EHP, the allied health professionals come in. What we're creating now are joint teams. So we've got integrated teams, for example, for people being discharged from hospital, which have physiotherapists, occupational therapists, social workers, and district nurses and care at home staff in. But one of those people will be allocated as the main worker for that person, and they can complain directly to them. But they can complain to anybody, and we will pick up the complaint and deal with it, regardless of what the service is about.
If you don't mind, can I just ask a question? It's about that issue. How do they know who to complain to? Right, if there's a multiplicity of people delivering service to a person, all right across the board, I mean, you don't want this multiple approach, like it could be the social worker or the carer or the health worker or whatever. What will it look like? Will everybody get a leaflet, for example, that says, if you want to complain, no matter who to, or what about, here is what to do? Will it be something like that? Is that in place tomorrow, now, or is that something that will happen next year?
Ms. Colvin.
Yes, it's in place just now. So any of our staff who go in to somebody's house to deliver a service or meet with them in hospital should get a leaflet that says, here's how you can make a complaint and here's who you would contact if you're not happy with the service. So, for example, Care at Home are probably, they're the biggest service we have. They deal with 5,500 service users every week. And basically everybody who receives Care at Home has a leaflet which tells them how to complain about the service and who to contact. And what I'm trying to say, I suppose, is that if somebody wanted and they made that contact, but they were actually complaining about the fact that their physiotherapist didn't turn up, well, we will not be saying you need to phone physiotherapy and make that complaint. What we will be saying is, right, thanks very much, we'll look into it, we'll get back to you as soon as possible and try and resolve your issue. So that it's about how we resolve the issues, not expecting our clients, our patients, to go around all the houses, basically. And that's the approach that we are developing just now.
Asha.
In answer to your question, Mr. Coffey, I mean, as I mentioned, we received 4,500 complaints last year about care, or at least from members of the public who are dissatisfied. Not all of those were things that we are empowered by statute to investigate. So some of them might be related to the provision of NHS services, so not something we could do. But what we would never do is to say to those people, well, I'm sorry, we can't help you. What we would do is support them to be in touch with the appropriate person in the area where they need to be and make sure that link is there. So I suppose, in a sense, some of what is being described at a local level, the Care Inspectorate does at a national level by providing that advice and support. So we have a telephone line that people can phone 5 days a week. It's staffed by complaints inspectors, who are specialised complaints inspectors, who will offer advice or support, and in some cases actually investigate the complaints that are being raised. But very often, actually, the provision of some advice and support can help people without the necessity to undertake a complaint investigation.
Ollie?
I was just going to come to you, Mr. Okasha, about the 4,400 complaints. I mean, as part of any complaints process, there's an expectation that there'll be some learning experience as a result of that, and that will inform future planning and improved service design. It's all part of the customer improvement, continuous improvement agenda that exists right across, well, all sectors, really. How do we know, how does the public know that amongst those 4,400 complaints that you get, that there are no repeats in there all over the place about the same issues over longer periods of time? How do we know that? And if any of those complaints result in recommendations for action, for example, with child protection issues somebody mentioned, how do we know that they're being addressed and fed back into the process so that certain issues can't happen again? That's a crucial element of the complaints management process and continuous improvement. So how does the public get the assurance that that's what happens?
Absolutely. So with respect to care services that we regulate, then we try and cut that information in two ways. So we try and cut that information by service, so that if someone is saying, well, I'm thinking of using this particular care service, we publish on our website details of all the complaints that have been upheld about that service by us, and we will say, well, here's the detail of the complaint. Now, obviously, we'll redact personal information about individuals, but we'll put a summary which says, we received a complaint in April 2013 about the quality of nutrition in that particular care service, to take an example, and we upheld this complaint and we made the following requirement that this must change. What we would then do is, when we then follow up and go in to inspect that service, we will use the information from that complaint to determine whether or not that requirement that we've made has actually been introduced and a change has happened. If that hasn't happened, then it's open to us to go further down our enforcement route to actually ensure that what happens, what we expect to happen, does happen. And I think that provides public assurance to someone who is either using a service or thinking of potentially using that particular service, because in social care there's often an element, more of an element of choice than in NHS services. But what we also then do is we can cut the data in terms of what's happening across the country, so we can provide a picture of, to say, well, these are the types of complaints potentially in a local authority area or in a health board area which we're getting. You know, we're getting lots of complaints about this particular issue in this area, and that will allow us then to target our scrutiny a bit more strategically and say, well, the data suggests there's a problem here, we need to start addressing that. So we publish that information in periodic reports as well. It's probably aimed more at the professional than the public user, but it's available.
That's a really good answer, but it doesn't quite get there. I think I was thinking more in terms of, say it's some child protection issues or whatever, and you've picked up an issue that's hopefully resolved. How do we know that other authorities, perhaps, that might be experiencing the same issue, who are not quite, you know, made recommendations directly against, how do we know that they pick up those lessons? Because we do hear of recurrences of things like child protection issues that happen across the country. How do we know that the authorities across the country are picking them up and actually taking action from recommendations made against that particular authority?
I think there's more work to be done in that area. We do a limited amount to an extent by when we have received a complaint where there's a real learning point for that service or for other services, we will publicise that through our various channels of communication in a kind of case study format. But I think you're right, I think there is potentially more work that could be done around ensuring that the information from complaints is shared more consistently across different parts of the country. When it comes to very serious matters, of course, there may well be a serious case review of some type whereby an awful lot of learning would be assimilated in one place and shared more consistently across an area. But that would really be in very serious cases where there was a very serious failing.
Okay, thanks very much for that, convener.
Okay, I'm going to go back to Ms. Colvin, because in answer to Mr. Coffey,
You said that folk, if they have a care package, could talk to their social worker or their health worker. What if they don't have a package and that forms part of the complaint? You know, some folk have got easy access to people on a day-to-day basis. Others do not, and that is one of the difficulties in terms of that. Beyond that, the complaint itself might be about the person who is dealing with their day-to-day care. So but, how do we deal with that?
Yeah. So if the complaint is about the person who's dealing with their day-to-day care, I mean, what we currently do is everybody has a leaflet with a phone number that they can phone to make a complaint. And that can be about the person who's dealing with their care. And the person at the end of the phone will make sure that we respond to that complaint appropriately as far as we can. And I mean, I did say earlier, we are moving from a siloed system into an integrated system, so there are complications in relation to this. We also advertise widely in terms of how you can make a complaint in relation to the partnership services. Now, most people don't see those as partnership services. They see them as NHS services and council services, and actually the staff still work for the NHS and the council, so we need to take that into account. The other thing that we do in Ayrshire and Arran is we are part of patient opinion, and we obviously get a lot of complaints or pre-complaints almost in terms of comments from people about their experience of using the NHS in Ayrshire and Arran, and we get quite a lot in mental health services. And in North Ayrshire, we're piloting care opinion as well, so that we're part of the pilot just now, the national pilot that's going on, so that people can contact us online and describe their experience, and we will respond as quickly as possible to people's experiences. So, and that would be particularly, quite often that is for people who don't necessarily have an allocated worker within the system. And that's how we're dealing with it just now.
Okay, Claire Adamson, please.
Thank you, Convener. We know that change of service and change of organisational structures is one of the most challenging things that people can face in work. And I mean this as no criticism of either social work workers or NHS staff, but just the history would show us that, you know, siloed mentalities can remain and there can be difficulties. So in the situation at the moment, if somebody makes a complaint and it goes into that confused middle ground, the social work services conduct their statutory duty on the complaint and NHS do the same, and neither of them take responsibility, who's the arbiter of where what's gone wrong in the service?
Ms. Taylor.
I would entirely endorse the observation about cultural challenge and the difficulty of moving to new ways of working, and particularly endorse the supportive nature of the observation, because it is very, very challenging. And as a slight counterpoint to it, I suppose, there's our observation from the quite extensive evidence around integrating health and social care that, oddly enough, moving everybody to one organisation doesn't fix it, which is part of the reason, of course, why this Parliament passed the legislation on integration that it has, which doesn't take that approach and instead leaves it, I suppose, to us all who work across the system to try to lead for improvement and work together very explicitly. In taking forward each of their statutory duties, social work and the NHS as providers of care, are fulfilling their responsibility, I suppose, and by aligning it so that each is following the same process, I would expect there to be considerably greater clarity about the steps that any given complaint moved through. I would hope that it was almost irrelevant, in fact, totally irrelevant to the person making the complaint, whether it was a social worker or NHS complaint, given that there will be a single point of entry and the same system of process in due course to go through to get to an outcome. But in terms of who must pick up the responsibility for resolving the complaint, it will lie with the integrated teams of the sort that Iona has described in her area.
Ms. Colvin?
Basically, as I described earlier, we've just put in place a joint management arrangement. So if you want to complain about community mental health services in Ayrshire, in North Ayrshire, with one manager who's responsible for the social work service and the NHS service, and their responsibility is to make sure that you get a response back to your complaint, that we try to resolve your complaint, be it about your NHS experience or your council experience, or in fact about both. And at the moment, I have for the last few months been dealing with complaints of that nature, where you get a complaint and actually it's about a number of issues in terms of both the NHS and the council response, or indeed, I think at the moment the systems are quite confused. People find it difficult sometimes how to get into certain parts of the service, and it's not clear why you would have why you would be involved in the council mental health service as opposed to the NHS mental health services. So one of the things that we're doing as a first priority is joining those services up together so that they become one service with one overall manager who has responsibility for both components of that service, and indeed it works with the third sector in terms of the delivery of their services as well, and has responsibility to resolve complaints as fast and as effectively as we possibly can. And we've just put that system into place in the last couple of weeks. And I have, at the moment, the join tends to be me and the people who work for me, the heads of service, so the people who are in charge of community care or in childcare or mental health. And we have been making sure so that we're not sending back responses that says, that's about the NHS, but you need to go through there, that's about the social work. But we are sending back responses that say we take on board what you're saying, and we're trying to resolve the issues in relation to both the NHS and the council service, or indeed sometimes it relates to third sector and independent sector services as well. We will be liaising with the care inspectorate around that.
Taylor, you wanted to come back.
Just very briefly, an additional point, rather at the other end of the spectrum from Iona's very helpful description of what, of course, is the primary concern, what happens to people who are making complaints on the ground. It strikes me that it may be worth me just mentioning briefly that the legislation around integration has within it a series of principles and also a series of outcomes, which are all to do with the well-being of individuals and the experience of care and the experience of the service users' family and so on and so forth. And these outcomes and principles at a legislative level apply not only to the partnership but also to the health board and the local authority. So bound into that legislation is a duty for everybody to be on the same page in terms of pursuing the well-being of the individual and the family around them and so forth. Thank you.
Claire?
Mr. McFadden, did you want to come in on that?
I think the point's maybe been slightly surpassed, but in response to your question about where things go and people are signposted, I think what Iona has outlined there in terms of agency, ownership and responsibility from behind the scenes in terms of making sure that the user doesn't have to unpick things, exactly what we're trying to get to, so that they enter the system. Getting to the system is the first challenge, and some people do struggle to identify where they go, what happens afterwards. At the moment, that isn't always happening across the country. I think people are going through the separate processes. They're then signposted to either the Complaints Review Committee or the SPSO, where we have different powers, and then, you know, what tends to happen is they don't follow all the processes. They follow one process, which narrows what they can actually complain about. So they complain about the health element, but they can't complain about the social care assessment element, or vice versa. So I think what Iona was talking about is where we're trying to get to, and I think that's where we do need a bit of clarity for all of the integrated joint boards and how they're able to do that within the existing legislative framework and the future legislative framework.
I am concerned that from the whole complexity of the situation, if there is a genuine disagreement between the health service and the social work service about where something has gone wrong, and individual workers have been highlighted as failing in their duty, obviously the council would have procedures for grievance, and somebody could go through if they were unhappy about a complaint of a fellow worker in those circumstances. But how does that work when it is two separate employers that are involved in the process?
Ms. Colvin.
It works through me and through the people that work for me, basically, because as the chief officer, I'm responsible for the social work service and the council service. All of that is delegated to me by the council and by the health board. So the IJB has the strategic responsibility and a number of other responsibilities, and I, as the chief officer, have both the strategic responsibility and the operational responsibility. So my managers, my heads of service, and now my senior managers, they all have that. They will discharge that responsibility. It's not acceptable that people get a response that says that actually it was the fault of the social worker, or no, it was the fault of the health worker. We need to resolve that. It's our responsibility to resolve that, and to resolve that to the satisfaction of our patient, client, service user, as far as we possibly can. Now, that's not been acknowledged, that's not been what's been happening up to now, but that is our aim, basically. So my manager, who's in charge of, for example, addiction services, we quite often get complaints that relate both to the health component and to the social care component. But it's his responsibility to make sure that we resolve that complaint and that we deal with any issues behind that. If there is a dispute between social care staff about what should be happening, then management need to help to resolve that dispute. And that's our responsibility, not the responsibility of the people who are making the complaint, clearly.
Thank you.
Alex Rowley, please.
Hi, good morning. Things seem a bit complex and a bit confused, and I'm not clear really where we're going. I mean, if I think about just last week, I had somebody come to me, an 80-year-old lady, or in her 80s, had been released from hospital, and the care package wasn't in place. And I didn't see that as a complaint as such. I just saw it as something that needed sorted. And by going to the interim director of health and social care, and it was cascaded for there and fixed. So there's that will be fixed. For me, the complaint would have come with that if, because it was clearly then to learn why that happened, but the complaint would have come if somebody had come back to me and said, yeah, we actually don't think that person deserves or should get care. And that would be where the complaint would come in, because you'd be challenging that decision. And for any complaints procedure that's in place, there's got to be confidence from the complainant. There's got to be confidence that it will be carried out, it will be examined properly, and there's got to be a clear process set out so that the person understands how that complaint will be dealt with. I assume the councils, well, the council does have that process right now. If I put a complaint in tomorrow to Fife Council and ask them what the procedure was, they'd be able to send me that. Likewise, NHS Fife would be able to send me that. And I suppose where I'm trying to get to is, where are we trying to get to with this? Are we saying that there is a streamlined complaints system that's going to be put in place for the Joint Integrated Health and Social Care Partnership, and that there will be a complaints procedure there that's in place that's then clear to people that this is what happens when you complain, this is the steps, and if you're not happy, you end up going to the Ombudsman or you end up going wherever. Is that where we're aiming to get to? And if we are, you know, should we as a committee, could you set that out for us? Could, perhaps not today, but set it in writing, where it is we're actually trying to get to go with this, what the steps are in getting there, and what, you know, there was interim guidance is going to be issued in the summer and whatever, and who's responsible for what. I think that would be useful if we got that type of information. We would then be able to see more clearly where this thing's going.
Ms. Taylor.
Yes,
we would be pleased to write back to you on that. I think that would be helpful. Thank you. Just I suppose, very, very briefly, in Fife, the health board and the local authority have appointed a chief officer. They have a shadow joint board in place. They have a draft scheme with us under discussion at the moment. And we expect that Fife partnership to put in place a front door for complaints, which makes it easy for the person making the complaint, as Iona has described from her area. But then the other part of your observation question, the process that flows, that speaks to what I mentioned earlier about having the same three-stage SPSO model process for health and social work. And we can set that out for the committee. Absolutely. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. Willie Coffey, please.
Could ask about the complaints outcome side to the process when a determination is made about whether a complaint is upheld or dismissed. What will the member of the public get? Will they get a letter? Will it be an invitation to meet with the single point of contact person? What will the person's experience be when a decision is made? And whatever the decision is, what will the signposting then be for that person to take it further if they choose to do so?
Mr. McFadden, are you signalling there?
Well, I think I was just going to outline what We set out as best practice in relation to other areas under the can model CHP, and I think it very much depends on the individual circumstances of the complaint. I think that's appropriate that it's tailored to the individual complaint, whether or not they get a chance to meet with the staff, or whether it's a letter. Or particularly where it's maybe a relatively straightforward complaint, we do encourage organisations to actually try and speak face-to-face, telephone, as simply as they possibly can, because I think we find our experiences that allows staff at the front line to be empowered to resolve things, for a start, which is definitely a positive, and allows the organisation to build empathy with the person where maybe something has gone wrong, and it can help to rebuild that relationship with them and allows them to maybe apologise. So I think it does depend, but I think these are the kind of things that you could set out for staff in the appropriate guidance.
I mean, is it clear what will happen then? You know, for a person having a response, what will happen tomorrow? If I keep using that example. If there's a decision made about a person today, what will they receive tomorrow?
Ms. Colvin. Sorry.
As far as possible, we endeavour to speak to people face-to-face or on the phone and try and resolve their issue. And so if somebody phones today and makes a complaint, somebody should phone them back and speak to them about their complaint and see how we can resolve the issue. If it gets to the second stage, and at the moment before it would go to a complaints review committee, then they would receive a letter from us outlining what the outcome of their complaint is, and if the complaint is upheld, they will receive an apology, of course. And they may, depending on how serious the complaint is, they may also be offered to meet as well. Not everybody wants to meet, but they may well be offered a meeting either with myself or a head of service or another manager, basically, to talk through their complaint and the outcome of their complaint. If the outcome of the complaint has significant implications for practice, then that would also be dealt with through our clinical and care governance arrangements as well, so that we're flagging up any practice issues and changes that need to be made to our practice or our arrangements within the services. And ultimately, that will also be scrutinised by the Integrated Joint Board as well, in terms of there will be a report presented to them about complaints that have been made about the service, about outcomes of complaints, and where there are significant issues, and particularly if it relates to children or to adult protection or indeed to public protection, then that goes into the system in terms of adverse events. So a significant case review for a child, for example, or for an adult, or a MAPA incident would also become public in their own right in terms of a report ultimately being published.
Do we see, you could ask Ms. Taylor, is that the experience that everyone will receive when there's an outcome or a decision made about a person's complaint? Will they have that experience commonly in Scotland, do you think?
It certainly should be. And I think this slightly goes back to something I said earlier, that it's the awareness that care itself, and indeed complaints about care as part of that, is not that well integrated everywhere, which has led us to this programme of reform, if you like. I think the evidence gathering that Mr. Okasha spoke about, that the Care Inspectorate and others intend to roll forward as we see implementation taking place, will be really important. We'll need to look at it really carefully to see whether, in fact, we are seeing that kind of integrated response quite consistently, if you like, or at least to a consistent degree of quality for people across the country. It's something we need to keep an eye on, I think.
When a person gets a response from the system to say, here's how we dealt with your complaint, is it still the same single point of contact if they want to come back in and raise an issue about that? Or do they get signposted to the Ombudsman? Do they leave the complaints process and go elsewhere?
After the two stages?
Yeah. If they're unhappy with it.
At the moment, if it's a complaint about social work service, then they would go to the Complaints Review Committee. It's not at the moment, but we would organise that. So when we give them the letter back, if it's a social work complaint just now, it's a complaint about social work service that's subject to the Social Work Complaints Review Committee, we'll see at the end of the letter, now if you're not happy, you need to tell us within 28 days and we will arrange a Complaints Review Committee. And that Complaints Review Committee is independent of us, obviously, and that would report into the Council, and at the moment it's reporting into the Council. If it's the NHS, then it's to the Ombudsman.
I see.
We have to tailor, at the moment we'll tailor the letters dependent on the nature of the complaint.
Right. Mr. Taylor?
But this of course is why the Cabinet Secretary's commitment to transition to the three-stage process for social work and the NHS will make it clearer in due course.
Thank you.
Okay. Following on from that, in terms of the new arrangements, the Care Inspectorate wrote to the committee on the 4th of May, signed off by the Deputy Chief Executive, then Director of Strategic Development, Karen Anderson. And in that letter it says, it's not at all clear what the leadership and coordinating arrangements are surrounding the development of a consistent pan-Scotland approach to a complaint procedure following integration of health and social care arrangements. I fear that unless this vacuum is filled, progress will be very limited. Has the Care Inspectorate changed its mind since it wrote that letter on the 4th of May, Mr. Okasha?
No, I mean, the position is very clear that we expect to see leadership and effective coordinating arrangements right across Scotland. I think the commitment to moving to the complaints handling process set out by the Ombudsman for both health and social care complaints, social work complaints, is extremely welcome. And I think that we would be extremely concerned if there were a vacuum. And what we need to do is be able to provide an evidence base to determine whether things are working as they're intended and envisaged, as we're hearing about today, or whether, in fact, things haven't worked, in which case that would be a very serious matter indeed.
So you still think there's a vacuum at this moment in time?
Well, we'd be highly concerned if there is a vacuum, and what we want to do is ensure that there is an evidence base to allow us to ensure that that vacuum has been filled and that there is effective and coordinating leadership arrangements. And I think what we've heard today, convener from the committee, is actually some very helpful examples from Ms. Colvin about the commitment from her particular partnership to making sure that there is effective leadership at that local level, that there is clarity for individuals who wish to make a complaint, and that there is no passing from pillar to post. What we will want to do is evidence that, and we want to ensure that what we hear matches up with what we see.
Wilson, please.
Thank you, Convener. Just to go back to Mr. Okasha. Mr. Okasha, you made a comment earlier in response to one of the questions about the Care Inspectorate providing a helpline 5 days a week. What happens those other 2 days? And I'm assuming those other 2 days are the weekends, because the example I cited earlier was an example of somebody being discharged from a hospital at 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon without a care package in place. That person might have decided they wanted to phone the Care Inspectorate to raise issues with that. Would they have got anybody at 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon?
We have on occasion been able to extend our helpline to be open at weekends and in the evenings where there's particular critical incidents happening in care services, and we want to provide extended support to people. I suppose what I wouldn't want to do is overclaim what our helpline does, and our helpline is not intended to be a national helpline for anyone with a concern about NHS services. That's not within our statutory power to look at. But what we can do is, when people do come to us, is signpost them in the right direction and support them. Many of the complaints that we deal with are when a care service itself has not been able to resolve an issue. So, in a sense, our role is to investigate complaints about care services when the care service themselves has not been able to put in place the necessary changes, or where people are frightened about going to it. So we would never claim to be an emergency response line in that sense.
Could I ask the same question to Ms. Colvin in terms of the similar scenario, someone released discharged at 5 o'clock on Friday afternoon without a care package? What would be the integrated partnership's response mechanism, and how would someone get in touch with the partnership to actually raise it? That is an issue.
Ms. Colvin, briefly, yep. Please.
Basically, we have an out-of-hours service, which is currently called Social Work Standby Service. We're doing some work to look at how we integrate all of the out-of-hours services, including our nursing, our doctor's service, and our social work service. And within that service, we have care-at-home managers on duty who should resolve the issue straight away, hopefully.
Right. Thank you very much indeed.
Okay. Mr. McFadden, in the SPSO's communications with the committee, you say that primary legislation is required to deal with this complaints procedure to make sure it's absolutely robust. Is that the case?
I think that's something we do need to clarify, and I think that the government's commitment to lay out the key steps towards this is important. The reason we felt that primary legislation may be necessary was because the social work changes would require the addition to a role of a remit of professional judgment over social work decisions, which would bring this complaints review committee role to us. We at the time felt that that may require primary legislation because it's fundamentally altering the SPSO Act 2002. I think there may have been discussion that there may be order-making powers or other such ways through alternative legislation that may be brought forward. But I think the position now, I think, would be say we need a bit of clarity on that.
Ms Taylor, you said that only secondary legislation is required to deal with these things. What's your reasoning? Why do you think that the SPSO is wrong in terms of saying that primary legislation may be necessary here?
Our assessment at this point is that it's possible under the order-making powers of the legislation. But I think there's more here that we need to discuss. We have yet to have the conversation with the parliamentary body about exactly how to take forward these changes. So perhaps I should temper my input to say we believe it's a secondary legislation issue, but we'll take that away and consider it more fully with our colleagues in the SPSO as well, and make sure that we're clear on what's required.
Well, in terms of writing back to the committee, as you've already agreed to do in a number of issues, I'd be grateful if you could write back to us as soon as possible to let us know exactly what the legislative route that you're going to take is going to be, whether that be primary or secondary legislation. I don't want to preempt the committee in any way, shape or form as we'll be discussing this evidence, but I think it's likely that we may be seeing you folks again before the end of the year, because I think that you may recognise that the committee is somewhat concerned at the way that this has been dealt with. I think that we will be keeping a very close eye on how progress is being made. I thank you for your evidence today, and I suspend and we move into private session.